The push for charter change in Congress makes headway. The House Committee of the Whole approved the proposal to amend some economic provisions of the 1987 Constitution. The House bid seeks to relax foreign investment limits in public utilities, education, and advertising. But progressive House lawmakers continue to voice their opposition.
If passed, Chacha will twist the principle to grossly favor foreign interests.
It is not a guarantee that it would be the sole key to economic prosperity.
Meanwhile, charter change advocates in the lower chamber defend their move. They also deny the education department's claim amending the charter will put the country's national security at risk.
May I ask if this is really an opinion of the Department of Education, or is it purely the fear of an individual who influenced the crafting of this official stand with regards to RBH7?
And the president clearly said, we have to open our country to more investments, but only, and that is why we support him, only economic amendments.
The House is planning to approve the proposed economic charter amendments before the Holy Week break on March 23rd. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. says he sees China's action in the West Philippine Sea with great alarm. The latest incidents between the Philippines and China happened earlier this week during Manila's resupply mission to Ayungin Shoal. The Philippines said Chinese Coast Guard ships caused two collisions with Philippine boats and water cannoned one of them, leaving four Filipino crew members injured. But for Marcos, while the encounter is alarming, it isn't a ground to invoke Manila's mutual defense treaty with Washington.
We continue to view with great alarm this continuing dangerous maneuvers and dangerous actions that are being done against our seamen, our Coast Guard, and in this time, they damaged the cargo ship and caused some injury to some of our seamen. And I think that we cannot view this in any way, but in the most serious way. Once again, we will make our objections known and hope that we can continue to communicate to find a way so that such actions are no longer seen.
For the National Task Force for the West Philippine Sea, this week's incident with China is the most severe yet.
There was this incident last year involving the Philippine Coast Guard, wherein there were a military grade laser was pointed at the Philippine Coast Guard vessel, which led to the temporary blindness of two of our personnel. And now it's this incident that happened yesterday where there's four minor injuries as a result of the glass windshield shattering. No, that's why there were minor injuries. So if the question is this the most serious? Yes, because now we have minor injuries that has happened.
Despite drawing international condemnation, China still sees nothing wrong with its behavior at sea. Beijing insists its Coast Guard acted with restraint in a recent clash with Philippine vessels. The Philippines earlier summoned China's deputy chief of mission in protest of the incident.
The Chinese Coast Guard responded to the Philippines' infringement and provocation at the Rinaya Shoal in accordance with the law. In this incident, who is initiating the provocation? Who violated international law and endangered peace and stability in the South China Sea? The truth is clear.
China also accuses the U.S. of being a troublemaker in the South China Sea.
The U.S. Department of State, who disregards the fact and confuses right with wrong, has made baseless attacks against China's legitimate and lawful actions to safeguard rights. It has arbitrarily threatened China by resorting to the U.S.-Philippines Mutual Defense Treaty to embolden the Philippines and endorse its acts of infringement and provocation. We firmly oppose it. China urges the U.S. to refrain from using the Philippines as a pawn to destabilize the South China Sea. The Philippines also needs to refrain from being manipulated by the U.S. Lessons from history tell us that a pawn will only end up being abandoned.
Beijing's foreign ministry, meanwhile, says the situation in the South China Sea is generally stable. This after ASEAN and Australia called for restraint from all parties in the vital waterway. The joint statement also called for a rules-based order in the Indo-Pacific. China says it has taken note of the statement, adding it remains committed to managing differences with other countries through dialogue and consultation. Despite the 2016 arbitral victory of the Philippines, China continues to claim almost the entire South China Sea. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. back home after participating in the ASEAN-Australia Special Summit. During his four-day trip, Marcos bagged some 86 billion pesos worth of investment deals. The Philippines also signed free trade agreements with Australia and New Zealand in a move seen to boost small businesses in the country. Marcos expressing hope Australia can help the Philippines in addressing the impact of climate change.
We must invite Australia to partner with the Philippines in our clean, green and renewable energy industry and other emerging technologies and introduce energy efficiency and conservation measures. Hosting the board in the Philippines will showcase global commitment to inclusivity, ensuring that the voices and experiences of the most affected countries are heard and considered in shaping the most urgent of global climate policies.
Aside from trade and investments, Marcos also underscores Australia's role in promoting peace and security in the region.
On maritime cooperation, we thank Australia for its consistent support for the rule of law, for the 1982 UNCLOS and the 2016 arbitral award, not only through timely statements of support, but also through capacity building and academic initiatives to mainstream appreciation of international law. We thus encourage Australia to continue its active engagement, both bilaterally and through ASEAN, to ensure the primacy of peace and stability through confidence building, preventive diplomacy, and conflict resolution in the region.
Tributes pour in for Jose Concepcion Jr. after the Filipino industrialist passed away Wednesday. Concepcion is remembered for his dedication to ensuring fair elections and restoring free enterprise in a post-martial law Philippines. Andrea Taguines with this report.
Many of you would like to know.
NAMFREL founder Jose Concepcion Jr., also known as Joe Con, passed away at the age of 92. His family confirmed through Go Negosyo. Concepcion was survived by his wife, Maria Victoria Araneta, and his eight children, including presidential advisor for jobs and Go Negosyo founder, Joey Concepcion.
My father was my mentor. His whole life was devoted to serving the country. He started NAMFREL even during the darkest days of this country. Today, I find myself doing the same thing. But different in a sense, more for the economy.
He was also remembered by NAMFREL colleagues as among the key players that sparked patriotism in the country. For Damaso Magbual, Concepcion was among those who played a role in bringing about the EDSA Revolution after he founded the National Citizens Movement for Free Elections, or NAMFREL, in 1983. He said Concepcion was determined to show the public not just the importance of casting a vote, but also safeguarding their ballots.
Joe Concepcion says that NAMFREL is just lighting a candle. When people light as many candles, the darkness will fade. That was why in 1986, he said, we were able to convince 500,000 volunteers.
NAMFREL went on to become a blueprint for election watchdogs in other parts of the world.
Yung first mga international exposure of NAMFREL was sending a contingent to first South Korea and then to Chile in around 1987. No? And then we sent about 125 volunteers also to Indonesia to train yung mga election observers.
Averia vows to continue the legacy left behind by Concepcion.
For example, the upcoming elections, no, we'll be recruiting more members again or more volunteers for the 2025 elections with focus on BARM. No? It's a first, no, in our history that the Bangsamoro will have its own elections. No? So our volunteers there are really preparing.
Concepcion was also appointed as Secretary of the Department of Trade and Industry under the administration of Corazon Aquino. In a statement, current DTI Chief Alfredo Pascual praised Concepcion's dedication to championing pro-Filipino policies. It was also under his leadership of RFM Corporation that it became a leading food and beverage conglomerate that was dedicated to keeping its products mass-based and affordable. Some of the country's biggest business groups also paying tribute to Concepcion, including the Makati Business Club and the PCCI. They honored him for his efforts to re-establish free enterprise in the country and a stronger engagement in international trade negotiations. The wake of Concepcion will be open to the public starting Thursday, March 7th from 4 p.m. to 10 p.m. and from March 8 to 10 from 1 p.m. to 10 p.m. at Chapel 4 and 5 of the Heritage Memorial Park in Taguig. Andrea Taguines, ABS-CBN News.
Let's now get an update on the weather from PAGASA forecaster Anna Clauren. Hi, Anna.
Yes, good morning, Bettina. Currently, the easterly is still prevailing over southern Luzon, Visayas, and Mindanao, and this will bring generally fair weather conditions over the whole country. Currently, we're not monitoring any weather disturbance that may affect the country for the next 3 to 5 days. And for the temperature forecast, we're expecting that here in Metro Manila, the range of temperature will be around 23 to 34 degrees Celsius, while in Baguio City is from 16 to 26 degrees, and in Tagaytay is 21 to 30 degrees Celsius. And that's the latest from PAGASA. This is Anna Clauren. Good morning.
Thank you very much for that update, Anna.